That's what God wants us to be here in Memphis, Tennessee. We need to be a catalyst for spiritual awakening, and we do that by loving Jesus Christ.
Good morning, and thanks for joining us for today's program. Pastor Steve is in a new series called Live Like It Matters, and today he'll be bringing us a great message straight from God's Word. Have your Bibles ready and join us. We'll also enjoy some great worship from our choir and orchestra and our worship band. And if you're looking for some encouragement to get through the week, check out our audio and video on demand at bellevue.org, where you can catch up on recent messages, or you can worship with us right here at Bellevue. Be sure to follow us on social at Bellevue Memphis throughout the week for inspirational and encouraging stories. I'll see you in just a few minutes with more information about today's program and how you can get connected right here at Bellevue.
Good morning, church family. Stand with us. We're going to sing and praise the Lord this morning. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? The King of Glory. Sing it together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. 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 Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
We'll be back with more worship and today's message in just a minute. Each week, our ladies get together to enjoy a time of fellowship, worship, and a great Bible study from Donna Gaines and other gifted teachers. This fall, our study is in the book of 1 Peter. Join us for a few minutes this morning as we look into this encouraging letter and discover outrageous hope and extravagant joy.
As I was looking at focusing on not the external, but on the internal, let's look at verse 4. And the Lord gave me some insight I've never seen before, and I'm so fired up about it. But let it be the hidden person of the heart. So God's saying, don't just focus on the outside. It's okay to look presentable. It's okay to take care of yourself. Your body's the temple of the Holy Spirit. But focus primarily on the inside, the inner person of the heart, with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. Now, I want us to think about something. Where else have we seen that word imperishable? We've seen it in 1 Peter. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 4, or chapter 1, verse 4. It says, to obtain an inheritance, which is what? Imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. So our inheritance, what we already have because we're in Christ Jesus, is imperishable. It will not pass away. And then in 1:18 through 19, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood as of a lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. So if we were not purchased with perishable things like silver and gold, but with the blood, what's the obvious contrast? It's imperishable. The blood of Jesus Christ is imperishable. So we've received an imperishable inheritance. We have been bought, purchased with the imperishable, precious blood of Jesus Christ. And we also, in fact, turn to the left to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Because these are the only other places in the New Testament that the word imperishable are used. There's several places in 1 Corinthians, but outside of 1 Peter. But this particular one I want us to look at in 52 and 53. It says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised, what? Imperishable. And we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. So what I realized was, as we are choosing to submit, we are choosing to obey the Lord. He is developing within us this gentle and quiet spirit that is imperishable. The imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit. And what hit me was the internal is eternal. These qualities that Christ is developing within us through his spirit, this gentle and quiet spirit, which gentle is simply controlled strength. It's strength of character. Quiet is tranquil, peaceful. Opposite of agitated and anxious, which our whole culture and society is. So yes, we're going to stand out when we're walking in peace and confidence and purpose because of who we are in Jesus Christ. But I was just blown away thinking that what he is developing within us right now is imperishable. It will be a part of us in our resurrected body. Is that not incredible? That what you're doing now by obeying Jesus Christ, by investing in his word, becoming conformed to the image of Jesus Christ is eternal. It's imperishable. Oh, ladies, age with grace. Focus on what's on the inside. Focus on the inner person, and you will grow ever more beautiful day by day as the radiance of Christ flows out of your life. Your countenance will be changed. The hope, the joy that you will exude will literally draw people to Jesus Christ. The internal is eternal. Don't ever forget that. So we're to have that gentle and quiet spirit, and this was the other thing that just rocked my world this weekend, that is precious in the sight of God. Okay, in 1 Peter 2, verse 4, it says, and coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God. Now, what did he just say up here? In chapter 3, he says, let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. Do you understand that as you are being conformed to Christ, as you are submitting to the Lord in every area of your life, surrendering yourself wholly and completely to him, trusting him, that's that quiet, inner strength of confidence in him, and peaceful, that gentle and quiet, peaceful, tranquil, that's trust. Choosing not to be anxious, but knowing you are entrusting yourself to the judge who will do right. He is righteous and faithful and true. And so you're entrusting yourself to him. And when you do that, it is precious in the sight of God. The exact same phrase used for Jesus Christ, the living stone, who was what? Rejected by men. You better believe your stand on the word of God and the way you live your life will be rejected by men. Jesus said the world hated him first. The world's not going to like us either. He said, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have what? Overcome the world. And because he has overcome, we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. So as we submit to him, we don't have to defend ourselves. He takes care of us. He goes before us. He prepares the way for us. He defends us. He strengthens us in our inner man as he makes us more like Christ. And as we walk with him, he opens our eyes to see. He gives us understanding of spiritual truth and reality that we will not have apart from an intimate walk with him. And that's what happens when we get in his word. He starts revealing himself to us. The only other time in all of Scripture that precious in the sight of God, that exact phrase is used according to the New American Standard Bible, is in Psalm 116:15, and it says, precious in the sight of God is the death of his godly ones. Jesus is precious in the sight of the God. Our inner person, holy and fully devoted to Jesus Christ, which develops that gentle, quiet spirit, is precious in the sight of God. Our death is precious in the sight of God. Why? Because death for a believer is merely a doorway into the presence of God, where we will never again grow old. We will never again be separated. We will never again experience death or disease, and he will wipe every tear from our eyes. The ultimate hope and joy in his presence. So submission and trust in the Lord leads to that inner tranquility and confidence. It's a concept that will be rejected. You will be ridiculed for submitting to your husband. You will be ridiculed for submitting to the word of God. In fact, there is a Christian woman right now who's just come out with a book about the Bible, and she's discrediting so much of the miraculous, and she's very popular on social media, and a very strong, theologically solid woman has written a review of her book, and she's spot on. But I'm telling you, it's dangerous, because when you start reading these things and they're not grounded and rooted in the word of God, it sounds good to the natural mind and to our rebellious nature. And it can incite that rebellion. And I can tell you what, my rebellious nature can be incited fairly easy. It doesn't take a whole lot. I have to take it to the cross every single day. In fact, just this morning. What are you going to teach on submission? And I'm in the kitchen, and I'm doing some stuff, and Steve's asking me questions, and sometimes that just bothers me because I'm focused, I'm trying to get some stuff done, and his questions don't always seem to be, in my opinion, valid. And so I kind of answered like that. And then I went, ugh, I'm so sorry. You know what? That was disrespectful, and I was being impatient with you. Would you forgive me? And he said, of course I will. I said, of course I'm teaching on submission this morning. Of course I'm going to be tested in the very thing that I'm teaching, right? That's why some people don't ever want to teach on it. They don't want to be tested in it. But I don't want to disrespect him, and I don't want to be short or impatient with him. And the problem is, at home, we let our guard down. I would never talk to one of my friends like that. I wouldn't be short and impatient with them. I wouldn't do that with them. Whether my children may be, but, you know, we don't treat our friends that way. So we don't need to treat anybody who lives within our home worse than we treat somebody outside. We don't need to treat somebody outside better than we treat the people in our home. And so that needs to be a reminder. And we need, you know, the Lord, if you're walking with the Holy Spirit, I mean, he convicts you immediately. I mean, a lot of times before it comes out of your mouth, but if not before, right after. You know, it's like, you know, you want to catch it and pull it back in, but you can't do it. So what do? You immediately ask for forgiveness. And you know what? That's a hard thing to do. It's a hard pill to swallow if you're a prideful person or you're walking in rebellion because you don't feel like you were actually wrong. It doesn't really matter whether you were right or wrong. What matters is the tone in which you said it and the way that you responded. And so we have to say, you know what? I shouldn't have said that way. And I apologize for that. We need to treat everyone with respect. What does the scripture say? In honor, prefer one another. So even if someone does not act honorable, we still honor them because they are created in the image of God and because we are loving the Lord and obeying His word as we honor them. And people, we know ourselves, I respond more favorably to kind treatment than harsh treatment. Hello, so do the people who live in our home. We need to be gracious and kind. We need to be loving and patient. We need to allow the Spirit of the living God to exude the fruit of the Spirit in our homes. And literally, when my children were at home, I finished almost every time of prayer with the Lord before I got them up, walking through my home, saying out loud, "Father, would you loose within the very atmosphere of my home the fruit of your Spirit, love, joy, peace." I mean, just walk through, talking out loud. God, I'm asking you to loose your spirit, not only within me, but within my home, within the atmosphere of my home. So as my family gets up this morning, they're going to encounter your presence in our home. And your fruit, the fruit of your spirit, your character will be evident in our home. So we need to be aware that we are to be accurate reflections of Jesus Christ in our home and everywhere we go. We cannot do that apart from submitting ourselves to God's word and submitting ourselves to those that He's put in authority over us, because that is a place of protection.
This world I will lay them at your feet and surrender every anxious thought for perfect peace, your perfect peace. All the loved ones I hold dear, my hopes and dreams and all my fears, I will choose to trust your name in everything, in everything. I will look up, for there is not above you. I will bow down to tell you that Jesus, Lord of all, oh Jesus, Lord of all, I will take you at your word. For Jesus, you have taken hold of me. All my life is in your hands. You are my strength, you are my strength. I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need you, Jesus, Lord of all. I will look back and see that you are faithful, and I look ahead, believing you are able, Jesus, Lord of all, Jesus, Lord of peace, perfect healer. All my life, all my cares on you, King of kings, mighty Savior. All my life, my cares on you, Prince of Peace, perfect healer. All my life, all my cares on you, King of Kings, mighty Savior. All my life, all my cares.
Today I'm talking about the family, and when I preach about the family, I just want to say this to you. There's nobody in here, including the Gaines family, that has a perfect family, all right? And if you think your family is perfect, you just illustrated that it's not, all right? Because that conception is false. All of us need help. And so I hope that you'll approach this sermon today with me as somebody just trying to find out what the Bible says. And let's just study. I don't want anybody in here to feel any guilt or any sorrow or any anxiety or anything like that. That's not God. I want to say this to you as plainly as I know how to say it. God never discourages us. Ever. Now, He'll convict you of sin, and He will even spank you. I know how that feels. He will discipline His children. But He will never, ever discourage you. God is the great encourager. Colossians 3, verses 18 through 21 might be the most compact statement on the family in the whole Bible. But it is powerful. Notice what he says in verse 18. Wives, be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be embittered against them. Children, be disobedient. Children, Lord, get all that out of my brain, all right. Be obedient to your parents in all things. See, I can't even read it right, all right. And to your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. I can remember Edgar exasperating me a few times, so that they will not lose heart. First thing I want to say to you is that God created the family. This is not something that was just something that man did as he evolved from a lower form of life. Number one, we did not evolve from a lower form of life. We were created in the image of a holy God, and God created family. And here's how He expected family to work. You know, God is a God of order. God is a God of authority. He is over everything, and then he gives certain authorities on earth, and all of us are under him. Now, the only reason I'm starting with the point that I'm starting with is because that's the way it flowed from Scripture in Colossians 3, verses 18 through 21. It starts with the wives. What are you to do? You are to respect and follow your husband. Respect and follow. And I know that's not popular nowadays. I understand that. I live in the same world you do. And all that really matters is that the Lord said it. And in a husband and wife relationship, the husband is the God-ordained leader. Now, before all you guys out there start ripping your shirts off and beating your chest and sounding like Johnny Weissmuller a few years ago, I just want you to know, that's Tarzan, by the way, but I just want you to know that it's a lot more responsibility than it is privilege. Being a leader is not an easy thing, and it's not something you should take lightly. We'll get to you in a minute. But the wife is not the biblical leader in the family. I'm talking about in the marriage. But the husband is. She is primarily a follower. And ladies, God's role for you, as long as he's not telling you to do something sinful. Now, I would draw a line, because your primary allegiance is to God. So if you've got a husband that's telling you to do something that's sinful, don't you do it. And if he's in any way abusing you physically, verbally, call the church, and we'll help you, all right? But you don't have to take anything. I'm not talking about physical abuse, anything like that. If your husband is hitting you, if he's abusing you verbally or anything else, cussing at you, call the church, and we will help you. We will. But if he's just talking to you calmly and he's not abusing you, you need to follow his leadership. Notice what the Bible says in Colossians 3:18. Wives, be subject or submissive to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Now, let me give you a little broader context of that. 1 Corinthians 11:3 is one of the verses that talks about the purpose of authority. It says, I want you to understand that Christ is the head, literally the authority of every man. The man is the head of the woman, and God is the head of Christ. Jesus exemplifies for all of us how to submit, does he not? I just ask you a question. He shows us how to submit. He submitted to the Father by leaving heaven to come and die on the cross for our sins. How many of you are glad, and how many of you believe it was a good thing for Jesus to submit to the will of the Father? Anybody out there? Okay. So submission's not a bad thing, okay? It's just lining up in authority. Jesus, the head of Jesus, is God the Father. And so he comes under that authority. And as long as Jesus was under that authority, he was in a perfectly safe place. Even though they killed him, he rose from the dead, all right? Now, the Bible says that the husband then is the head of the wife. So the husband comes under Christ. Christ is under the father, and the wife comes under the husband. That doesn't mean she's subordinate in the sense of substandard or anything like that. Women are not less meaningful than anybody else, but it does mean that there's a line of authority. Now, I want to show you something. When you're all lined up, Jesus is going to be under God. You don't have to worry about that. If the husband will come under Jesus and the wife will come under the husband, you know what it's like? It's like coming, for the wife, it's like coming under Jesus. Now, husbands, if you're not under Jesus, you're really making it hard for your wife. So why would you do that? But I'll get to you in a minute. Ladies, bottom line is, you come under the authority of Christ by coming under the authority of your husband. And when you do that, you know what? You can't help what your husband does. You can talk to him and encourage him, but your responsibility is to do what God tells you to do. And when you do that, you are under the protective shield of Almighty God. And when you don't do that, like the world a lot of times tells you, you just do your own thing. You are a woman. Hear me roar, you know. I'll tell you why you're roaring is you're getting beat up by the devil. That's why. So don't do that. Come on, let's just come under the Lord. Let's all come under the Lord. Men, let's come under the Lord. Because Jesus is under Christ. The Christ is under the Father. And that way the devil can't pick us off. He can't beat our families up. He can't destroy us. Bible says in Ephesians 5:21, through 24, further submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. All of us are to submit. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Did you see that? As to the Lord. Jesus, I'm going to do this as unto you. For wives, this means submit to your husband as to the Lord. Verse 23, for a husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. I want you to know that. I'm not the head of the church. Jesus is the head of this church. I submit to Jesus, all right? Christ is the head of the church. He's the Savior of the body and the church. As the church submits to Christ, so wives should submit to their husbands in everything. A couple more times, Ephesians 5:33. So again, I say each man must love his wife as he loves himself. The wife must respect her husband. Ladies, I just want to say this to you. Your husband will never be more than you want him to be. If you constantly pick at him, you constantly down him, you constantly, put him down and try to put him in his place. And let me just say that, try to make him not be a man. You try to domesticate him. He is not your project. He is a person. And he needs to be able to be a man. Not something you create like a she-man, all right? He needs to be a man. And sometimes men just like to do manly things. And usually it involves dirt, all right? I don't know why. It just does. But quit trying to domesticate your husband. Stop it. Don't do that. It's bad. 1 Timothy 2:12, I do not let women teach men or have authority over them. Let them listen quietly. 1 Peter 3, in the same way, you wives must accept the authority of your husband. Then even if some refuse to obey the good news, your godly lives will speak to them without any words. They will be won over by observing your pure and reverent lives. Don't be concerned about the outward beauty of fancy hairstyles, expensive jewelry, beautiful clothes. Rather, you should clothe yourself instead with the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God. You will not hear that in the media today, but you hear it in the Word of God. No wife will ever be truly fulfilled unless you respect and follow the lead of your husband. Number two, husbands, love and lead your wives. Love them and lead them. Men, our wives are commanded to respect and follow. We're commanded to love and to lead. Let's be somebody they'd want to respect and they'd want to follow. Love them by leading them. Lead them by loving them. You're not supposed to be passive. So many men are hesitant. They're not proactive. We're not supposed to be wimps. God calls us to be warriors for our family. We are to be proactive. We are to be proactive in how we serve our families, how we provide for our families, how we protect our families. We're to call out to the Lord in prayer for our families. We're to set a godly example for our families. We're to love our wives. Now listen to what I'm about to say. Husband, you are to love your wife the way you want Jesus Christ to love you. Colossians 3:19, husbands, love your wives. Don't be embittered against them. Ephesians 5:25-26, husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. How did he love the church? He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. 1 Peter 3:7, in the same way you husbands must give honor to your wives. I don't like to hear a man laughingly telling jokes about his wife. In fact, it makes me mad. I'd like to tell you it was holy anger. It's probably not. I don't like to hear some man downing his wife. It says here, you're supposed to treat her with understanding and with honor and to live together. She may be weaker. She is your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Treat her as you should so your prayers will not be hindered. I want to tell you this. You will not pray right if you're not being right with your wife. won't happen. And then children, honor and obey your parents. No child should be allowed to talk back to mom and dad without consequences. And consequences are not saying, now, Johnny, that's not consequences. I'm talking about consequences. They should not be allowed to rebel, because when they grow up and they do that, the world's not going to let them do it without paying a price. What are children supposed to do? Well, it's pretty plain. Children, be obedient to your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. Ephesians 6, 1 through 3, children, obey your parents in the Lord. This is right. Honor your father and mother. That's the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you, that you may live long on the earth. I think you know I have an exceptional wife. And one of the ways she loved me through the years was loving my mom and dad. If we had a week, I only got 2 weeks off for years. I went a long time just having 2 weeks off. We didn't have any money, so we'd come home to Tennessee, and Donna would always, if I couldn't be there, she was not one of these that would just pull the grandchildren away. She always made sure that the kids were half and half wherever we were. She was holding my mother's hand when my mother died. So I had a wife that honored my parents, not only hers. Honor your parents and obey them. And one of these days, when if you get the opportunity, take care of them when they can't take care of themselves. And then parents, encourage and discipline and instruct your children. Colossians 3:21, fathers, don't exasperate your children so that they will not lose heart. The world can be a cruel place. And you know what is making the world a very cruel place? Look at me right here. Right there. I want to say this to you. I'm not mad. But I was walking through church today. Everybody was doing this. I'm not talking about in here. Some of y'all are doing it right now. You say, how do you know? I just know you. I know you. And kids can really beat up on each other on this little thing right here. And they come home, if they hear that same kind of negativity, home needs to be a haven, a safe haven. Don't you believe that? Where we pray for them. Grandparents, you say, well, I don't have kids anymore. Pray for I pray for them, all of my grandkids. We're going from 11 to 14 in the next few months. Amen? And I know every one of their names, and praise God, Donna knows all of their birthdays. I don't know any of their birthdays, but I know their names. I said, who's having a birthday this month? Ephesians 6:4, fathers, don't provoke your children to anger, but by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and the instruction that comes from the Lord. God created family. And parents, one thing I would say to you, it's okay to be their friend, but don't always be their buddy. Sometimes they don't need a buddy. Sometimes they need a parent. God created family. Now, number two, God crowned the family. He did it with marriage. Nothing more sacred on earth than marriage. Matthew 19, 4 through 6, Jesus is speaking about marriage. He answered them and said, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female? He said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother, shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. He's quoting the oldest scripture in the Bible on marriage. It's Genesis 2:24. So they're no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. I read that text at every wedding I perform. Has a lot to say about marriage. So let me just talk to you a little bit real quick about what the Bible says about marriage. Then I want to get to the last point. Marriage is God ordained. It's God ordained. It's something that God wanted Bible says in Genesis 2, verse 18, then the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I was preaching on that one time, and the lady said, yeah, because he tears up the house while the wife is gone. That's right. It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him. Verse 21, so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. The Lord fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man and brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Marriage is not something that man came up with. It's something that God designed. What does the Bible say about marriage? Well, marriage, number one, is heterosexual. There is no gay marriage in the Bible. There's no homosexual marriage in the Bible. That's a contradiction of terms. Genesis 1:27, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. He made the males to be males and the females to be females. Genesis 2:18, then the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I'll make him a helper suitable for him. The woman and the man are They fit not only biologically, but emotionally and every other way. They are made for one another, literally made for one. And then the oldest text is Genesis 2:24. For this reason, verse 24, for this cause, marriage, a man shall leave his father and mother, shall cleave or join to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And Jesus quoted that in Matthew 9:5, and Paul quoted it in Ephesians 5:31, there is no hint of any homosexual marriage in Scripture. Every time the Bible speaks of homosexuality and lesbianism, it says the same thing that it says about fornication and adultery. It says that homosexuality and lesbianism and adultery and fornication, they're all contrary to the will of God. They are all sin. There is no verse of Scripture that says homosexuality is okay and homosexual marriage is okay. It is not okay. And what the Supreme Court did a few years ago was an abomination to God. Marriage is heterosexual. Number two, marriage is monogamous. It's only one man and one woman. Before Genesis 3, there was only one man and one woman. And then Jesus comes and he says, look, you want to talk about marriage? Let's go back to Genesis 2. Originally, it's one man and one woman. Let's just read what Jesus said in Matthew 19:5. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, shall be joined to his wife, the two shall become one flesh. You have one man and one woman, one father and one mother. Marriage is exclusively monogamous. It also is a new beginning. Genesis 2:24. I'm having to hit these things very quickly. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined or cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. What happens is you have to leave. You don't have to, listen. You can leave physically and still be attached to your parents in an unhealthy way. A lot of parents want their kids to do what they want them to do even after they get married. I want to say, what I always tell young couples is, you'll either leave and cleave or you will grieve. Now you can live next door to your parents and leave. It's not about, distance. It's not about geographical distance. It's about changing your primary loyalties away from your parents to your spouse. And now what your spouse wants is more important than what your parents want. And if you don't do that, you're going to be in trouble. You've got to leave. You've got to create a new family. And just a little advice real quick before I go on these other points. If you're married out there and you've got in-laws that are constantly saying, well, why don't you come over more? Well, why don't you do this? That's manipulation. Don't give in to that. And if you're doing that, parents, stop. You're going to run them off. Just stop. What you do is Y'all, what Don and I decided, we're going to decide what we need to do. She'll tell her parents. I'm not going to tell her parents. She'll tell her parents. I'll tell mine. All right? It's a new beginning. It's a brand new family. And you young people out there, you need to decide how you want to relate. Be kind, be sweet. Again, you're going to reap what you sow. All you young folks out there, you're going to reap what you sow. Don't be ugly. Don't be arrogant. Don't you go out of here saying, Brother Steve said, I can tell my parents off. Only if you want to be told off about 20 years from now. That's not what I'm saying. You got to be kind. You always have to be respectful. But it's okay if you don't want to be told everything to do by your parents or your in-laws. It's okay. You do what the Lord wants you to do. Number whatever, marriage is for companionship. Genesis 2:18, it's not good for man to be alone. Proverbs 18:22, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Ecclesiastes 4:9, two are better than one because they have good return for their labor. For if either of them falls, the one will lift up his companion, but woe to the one who falls when there is not another to lift him up. Furthermore, if two lie, the reason I know this is about marriage is this verse right here. If two lie down together, they keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? I will tell you this, the older you get, the more you just enjoy hanging out. Just hanging out. There's nothing I'd rather do than just hang out with her. And that's the way it ought to be. And marriage is for companionship. Marriage is for sanctification. Marriage is for sanctification. I won't read all of Ephesians 5, but it talks about husbands, you have to love your wife, you have to lead your wife, you have to really love her like Christ, and you have to give up your rights. Ma'am, you have to love your husband and submit to him. You're both having to work at it, and you'll work at it as long as you're married. Marriage, to have a long marriage, you have to keep falling in love with the same person over and over again. And it's not easy. You don't always get to do what you want to do. Newsflash, it's sanctification. It makes you more like Jesus because you constantly have to give up things that you'd like to do. You constantly have to talk and say things that you don't really want to say. And I'm talking about being kind and all that when you really want to lash out and the Holy Spirit has to work through you. It is one of the major sanctification tools. It'll make you more like Jesus. All right, marriage is for intimacy. The only way you're supposed to be involved with anybody sexually is one man and one woman in marriage. That's it. Not before marriage, not extramarital, not homosexuality, not lesbianism, not anything. Not adultery, not fornication. It's all wrong. The only place for physical intimacy is marriage. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife. That means, literally, joined to your wife. The two shall become one flesh. Marriage is for procreation. I got a lot of verses you can read on these. It says in Genesis 4, the man had relations. He knew his wife. It means he was intimate with her physically. And she conceived and gave birth to Cain. And they did another one, had Abel. Marriage is sacred. God created it. Hebrews 13:4, I am going to read that. Marriage is to be held in honor among all. And the marriage bed is to be undefiled. Fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. Can I have an amen right there? Amen. He will. And then marriage is for keeps. Matthew 19, verse 6 says this, so there are no longer two but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. All right, God created the family, God crowned the family, God celebrates the family. I want you to write in those two blanks there, and then we're going to stand up and read these scriptures, all right? Write down children, where it says children are more important than work.
Don't quit your job over it, but I just want to tell you, they're more important even than your job. And then write this down. Families determine the strength of a nation. No nation will be stronger than its family. Why do you think the devil is attacking the family so much in America? All right, let's all stand up. This is not time to leave. This is time to stretch your legs. And now I can say I finished by 10:30. All right. Although I will tell you, Brother Mark gave it to me late today. I want you to know that, all right? So anyway, all right. First thing, we're going to talk about children are more important than work. Look at this. Let's read it together. Here we go. Unless the Lord builds a house, the work of the builders is wasted. Unless the Lord protects a city, guarding it with sentries will do no good. Now watch this. It is useless for you to work so hard from early morning until late at night, anxiously working for food to eat, for God gives rest to His loved one. Now, what's the next verse? Children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from Him. Children born to a young man are like arrows in a warrior's hand. How joyful is the man whose quiver is full of them. He will not be put to shame when he confronts his accusers at the city gates. Now, I just want you to know, if you're sacrificing your children on the altar of work, you're not doing right. I'm not saying don't work. You said, a while ago you said work. I know that, but you got to get everything. It's a balance thing, amen? And you got to make time. Listen to me. I found out a long time ago there's a lot of people that would love to be your pastor and could be your pastor, but there's only one person that could be my children's father, and that's me. So I'm going to be my kid's father. I went to the games. I ate those nasty chicken sandwiches at those ball games. That's the nastiest thing I ever put in my life, my mouth. And I kept buying them. I don't know why. Wasn't anything else to eat, but I went. I went to foo-foo things like ballet, you know, dancing around and doing all this stuff and all that mess, you know. I've done it all right? And I smiled while I did it. Why? Because children are more important than even my job. And then families determine the strength of a nation. I think Psalm 128 is something you ought to pray for the families of our nation. Again, I don't want to be ugly, but these things right here are destroying our families. Because even when we're physically together, we're not together. We're in our computer, we're in a phone. Turn these things off when you go home. Oh, but what if I get a call? Don't answer it. Turn them off. Let's read this together and we'll be through. How joyful are those who fear the Lord, all who follow His ways. You will enjoy the fruit of your labor. How joyful and prosperous you will be. Your wife will be like a fruitful grapevine flourishing within your home. Your children will be like vigorous young olive trees as they sit around your table. That is the Lord's blessing for those who fear Him. May the Lord continually bless you from Zion. May you see Jerusalem prosper as long as you live. May you live to enjoy your grandchildren. May Israel have peace. Now you can have a great family and still die and go to hell. It's not good enough just to have a good family. You've got to be in the family of God. Thank you so much for watching. And the reason we have these broadcasts primarily is to tell people who don't know Christ as Lord and Savior how they can be saved and how they can come to know God through His Son, Jesus Christ. I want to remind you that God loves you. He loves you, the Bible says, with an everlasting love. And He loves everybody in this world, for God so loved the world, the Bible says. He loves you. But the same Bible says that you're a sinner. That's spiritual law breaking. You have broken the laws of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the wages or the just penalty of our sin is death. And it makes us spiritually separated from God. But the beauty of Christianity is this: God doesn't expect us to swim out of our own ocean of sin. No, He doesn't expect us to save ourselves. When we were drowning in our sin, Jesus came to us, and the Bible says that God loved us so much, He sent Jesus to die on a cross for our sins, to pay the penalty, and then to be raised from the dead, that He might give us eternal life. And if you will believe that, if you'll receive Christ, He can save you right now. You have to repent of your sins, believe in Jesus, and ask Him to come into your life. And if that's something you'd like to do right now, I'd love to lead you in that prayer of commitment. And you can pray and tell the Lord that you want to be saved and ask Him to be your Lord and Savior. If that's what you want right now, pray this with me right now where you are. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus, thank You that You love me. I am a sinner. I cannot save myself. I believe that You died on the cross for me. I repent of my sin. I turn from my sin. I believe that You not only died for me, but You rose from the dead. And Lord, I receive You into my life. Save me right now, Lord Jesus. Wash me and cleanse me, and help me to live for You for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen." Well, dear friend, if you just prayed to receive Christ into your life, the Bible says that angels are rejoicing, and we at Bellevue would love to rejoice with you as well. There's a toll-free number on your screen. Someone is waiting here at Bellevue to pray with you, to rejoice with you, and to be blessed by hearing about your conversion to Christ. We're going to send some materials to you to help you get started in the Christian life. And if you need a Bible, let us know. We'll send one to you absolutely free. And then you still have time to worship with us here today at Bellevue Baptist Church. In just a moment, you'll see the location and also the times. We'd love to have you come today. God bless you, and I rejoice with you that you've given your heart to Jesus Christ.
If you're in need of spiritual help, call us at 1-866-347-5431. There are caring people waiting right now to take your call. For more information about Bellevue, explore our website at bellevue.org, where you can catch up on recent messages from Pastor Steve and other great speakers through our audio and video on demand. Or follow us on social media at Bellevue Memphis throughout the week for inspirational and encouraging stories. And tune into our live webcast every Sunday at 9:20 and 11 a.m. and Sunday evenings at 6 p.m. We'd also like to invite you to join us for worship this Sunday here at Bellevue. You're always welcome, and there is a place here for you and your family to connect. Check out bellevue.org for a complete list of worship times. Thanks for joining us for today's program. We look forward to seeing you soon.